Hello, everyone. I'm Matthew Houde, Vice President of Government Relations at Dartmouth-Hitchcock. Two communities at two different stages of progression along their housing journey. It's the perfect setup for this afternoon's discussion on workforce housing and zoning, a problem made even worse by COVID-19 and the current housing frenzy. Many homes are selling well over asking price, and apartments are too few and too costly for many people. Without a doubt, we have a housing and workforce crisis on our hands. So what do we do about it? With me this hour is filmmaker Jay Childs. He produced Communities and Consequences 2 in partnership with demographer Peter Francese and writer and former agricultural commissioner Lorraine Merrill. New Hampshire PBS is the presenting station. Also joining us is Sarah Wrightsman. Sarah is the executive director of the Workforce Coalition, Housing Coalition, excuse me, of the Greater Seacoast and the housing coordinator for the Regional Economic Development Center and a member of her town's planning board. Sarah is also the host of New Hampshire-based podcast, Creative Guts. We are recording this afternoon's conversation and we'll make the link available on nhpbs.org/communitiesandconsequences webpage. If you have any questions for our panelists, please post them in our chat window. We'll get to as many of them as we can in the course of this conversation. Sarah, let's start with a definition. What is workforce or affordable housing, and why is it so controversial?
Sure. So affordable housing is a term that I don't often use, and it's because affordable just means that you're not spending more than 30% of your household income on your housing costs. And so it's pretty subjective. All housing is affordable to someone. Workforce housing, on the other hand, we have a state law that provides a sort of a guiding definition for us. So workforce housing is rental housing that's affordable to folks making up to 60% of the area median income, and those areas are defined by HUD, and it's for sale housing that's affordable to folks making up to 100% of the area median income. And I love the term workforce housing because it's very literal. It's housing for the workforce, but unfortunately it's become jargon and it's become something that is controversial because it conjures up images in people's heads that may or may not, of course, be true, but it's become something that is sort of a jargon or a scary or an unknown what that means. But really what workforce housing is, and when you look at not the legalese of the workforce housing law and the legalese of that definition and, you know, the numbers and the data, but when we're looking at the spirit of the law, what we're really talking about is people. So it's not what is workforce housing, but who is workforce housing? Who are those people in your community that we need to house that are unable to afford to live in the community that they work in or within a reasonable commuting distance of their job? So. And even in the most rural communities, every community has some workforce. They have municipal staff or the folks who work at the post office or the library, school teachers, police officers, firefighters, you know, even like small businesses. So even the most rural communities have some workforce. And where do those folks live? And can they afford to live in the community that they work in or within a reasonable distance? So
really helpful. Thank you. So the housing frenzy that we're seeing, homes on the market gone moments after they're listed, second home influx, et cetera, seems only to be making the problem worse. What, if anything, can be done to expand the inventory of affordable or workforce housing?
Yeah, certainly. We desperately need more supply, especially now. The pandemic did not cause a housing crisis, but it certainly accelerated what was already happening in New Hampshire. And I think for the first time in more than a decade right now, we're measuring. So we measure housing supply on the for sale side in months of supply, meaning if no new houses came on the market, this is how long it would take for all of the houses that we have listed to disappear. And it's, you know, a healthy market is something like 5 months of housing supply, 6 months of housing supply. And right now, for the first time in more than a decade, we're measuring our months of supply in weeks. We have 0.7, you know, months of supply on our housing side. So it's incredibly tight. And, you know, prospective homeowners, home buyers are really feeling this crunch. across the state, and you've probably heard this from folks, especially that are like first time buyers and the folks who can't compete with cash offers. And, you know, houses are, I think a lot, anybody who's sort of looked at the housing market and tried to buy in the last year, including myself, I bought my first home with my husband last November, sort of has their horror stories of how that went down. And so we desperately need more supply, and we need that supply to be more affordable to members of the workforce making, you know, a range of incomes from lower than 60% of area median income to also maybe all the way up to 100 or greater than that, because those folks are having a hard time affording housing right now. And a big part of that is changing our zoning so that developers can do their role, which is develop housing and make sure that they can develop housing that's a little bit more affordable, a little bit more moderately priced for members of the workforce.
So I won't put you on the spot with respect to your personal story yet. We'll see how the hour develops. But I know that you live, work, and breathe housing policy. So I have a two-part question for you. Why do you do it? But also, what sustains you in that work, particularly in these times where it's so challenging?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I will share a little bit of my own housing story, because I think that's important. You know, when we talk about these folks who live in workforce housing, you might have this like idea that comes into your mind, but it's really most of us, arguably all of us. Like when we talk about workforce housing, we're really talking about housing for us and our, you know, our grown children or our aging parents or our, you know, employees. If you're a business owner, we're really talking about housing for like people that you know and people that you like and respect and, you know, have in your life. Like when you go to, say, downtown Portsmouth, for example, and you're eating at your favorite restaurant, like the chef who cooked your food, that's a person who needs somewhere to be able to live. And so my own sort of housing story and my buying a home in the middle of a pandemic when I know better and I knew how bad the housing market was sort of driven by the pandemic. I was living in a one-bedroom apartment and I was working from home, and my husband works nights, and so he was around all the time, and we thought, you know, I think we need a little bit more space, and that drove us to start looking, and it was heartbreaking more than anything else, sort of losing out to folks who were paying with cash, even when we were the higher offer, which was interesting, and having to do things like waiving inspection, because getting an inspection was just, we were not going to be competitive, and our offer wasn't going to be competitive in that scenario, so I think how I ended up here was a desire to help people. And I never really was super picky about what that meant. You know, I wanted to do something that was meaningful and addressed systemic changes. And that's exactly what I'm doing. And I sort of lucked into this role and into housing specifically as my thing. And the second part of your question is what sustains me when things are frustrating. It's a really good question, because sometimes it does get frustrating and there are enough losses in a row that I think like, you know, what am I doing? And then something good happens. We get some wins. And when you see, like, for example, from Communities and Consequences, the Conway story, that kind of thing just warms your heart and pulls you right back into the game and wanting to do this.
Well, thank you for doing the work that you're doing. And you referenced one of the two stories that we saw this week. And what I'd like to do is I'd ask you to speak to the role for the state and federal government in solving this crisis. For example, Governor Sununu is seeking permission from the federal government to use federal money to help people pay rent. That was designed to help people pay for rent during the pandemic, to also build new rental units as well. And I was wondering, in addition to the federal and state role that I'd like to just speak to, I imagine all levels need to pitch in to help here.
Yeah, absolutely. And most of our work happens at the local level, but we certainly will participate in some advocacy when there are things happening at the state level where, you know, we see a real possibility for impact. And this was a frustrating legislative session, I think not just for housing folks, but for a lot of people. There were some sort of great, really promising housing bills that came across the House and the Senate that unfortunately didn't make it very far. And that was frustrating. And it really redirected my attention to focusing on the local level. And I've talked to, say, like Senator Shaheen's office before, like, how can the federal government play a role in this? And I don't have a great answer for it yet. But I think there is some potential there in the idea of, say, using some federal funding to help us get some things done could certainly be very, very helpful.
Thank you. So Jay, I'm going to pivot if I can to you.
Sure.
I know that you spent years working on this film, and every day there are new developments on the housing front. Do you think we're at a tipping point in terms of change in that space?
I think we are the only tipping point I would safely, you know, I'm not a prognosticator, that I would say is that we have really begun to see around the state the difference between the first film and the second film is a focus on action. There was a lot of talk when we did the first film back in 2008 of raising awareness and beginning discussions. And I know those things are important. But, you know, Sarah and I tend to be like, you know, if I hear one more time about starting a discussion. So I think, you know, Andy Dean summed it up, that there's really been a focus on trying to get some shovels in the ground and do what needs to be done, because the economic crisis is hitting us right now. And, you know, you're seeing it with employers stepping forward, and they are a big voice that's part of this, making the case at planning board meetings and other meetings, and putting some skin in the game, that there are very real impacts if we don't move from just sort of talking about the issue to addressing it and getting some shovels in the ground.
So I think that actually addresses in part the second question I had for you, but I'm going to ask it anyway, just to flesh it out a bit more, which is what have you hoped to accomplish with the film? And it sounds like there was a movement from discussion to action. And so if you could speak to that would be great.
Yeah. I think, you know, the funny thing about documentary is you don't control the outcome. You know, you can't. And there were some stories. We have the story of Pelham, where they seem to be moving in a direction, and then not so much. It was really turned out to be a cautionary tale. Here in Conway, we saw that there really was some movement. And the latest that I got from Steve Porter, and it's very interesting that the Avesta project that they talked about is set to break ground. They want to break ground this coming fall. What has been a major delay with a lot of projects is the skyrocketing cost and unavailability of key material components coming out of COVID. Also, Andrew Winter gave me an update. Tracy Street is going great, and they are now working in White River Junction, just over the bridge, on a 21-unit affordable housing project, 4 units in phase one, 17 units in phase two, and they're working again with Massacoma Bank to do the financing. So, you know, I was hoping that the film would provide some positive ideas rather than simply relitigating the problem, that people could see and say, you know what, that might work in my town. You know, everything doesn't work everywhere, but ideas that maybe are portable for people to look at in their own community and think, you know, there's a person who's been advocating for years in my community. What can I do to help them? Like, what can I do to get behind them? You know, I can't do something full time. I can't turn my life over to this, but what's the one thing that I could do that would make this happen?
So it's interesting. You mentioned the effort in the Upper Valley where I live. And I know Andrew Winter and Massacoma Bank were collaborative on that effort. There is absolutely a workforce housing challenge. If you think about the number of employees alone that need to be hired to provide the amount of care that we provide to our patients in the region. And we're not alone, right? I mean, there's businesses in the Upper Valley who are equally stretched in that space. I did just want to acknowledge what a driver Andrew is and Twin Pines in that space, in this area. I'll add my own personal story, Sarah, to your observation, actually, and Jay, yours. We needed to have work done on the house, and it was in the middle of COVID, and the contractor truly laughed at us that we got in touch with, which I think was the fourth or fifth contractor. It was just not a tenable situation. Okay, so we're getting questions in that I want to pose, and I'm going to ask both of you these questions. So whoever wants to tackle them first, I'm going to start with I noted in the clip a question raised by the planning board, by a planning board member, as to the implications of increasing housing on cost to the schools and social services. And so I was hoping that you could address some of the myths that seem to be perpetuated around local zoning and affordable housing.
I'll start, Jay, if you don't mind. It's interesting, that point stuck out to me too, because the impact on our sort of community services of workforce or affordable housing isn't any different. It's the same as any other type of housing. And yet when you're talking about, say, a developer comes in and they want to develop single family housing, we don't tend to have those same conversations about what about the school children or the, you know, the community services that we do when it's workforce housing. And in fact, when we're talking about particularly the school children part of it, multifamily housing brings in far fewer students per unit than single family housing does. And it's a tiny fraction of what we sort of fear when we're talking about that sort of, like, you know, visceral response that someone who is opposed to housing or concerned about that might think. It's nowhere near, you know, two kids per unit. It's more like, you know, for rental housing, for multifamily housing, it's more like 0.17 kids per unit or something like that. And we have this great data that's been accumulated by both Russ Tebow of Applied Economic Research did some research on this specifically and looked at that. And for, you know, for single family housing, I think it's closer to something like 0.4 kids per unit when we're talking about single family detached housing. So it's interesting that we have this concern about what multifamily housing will do in terms of school children, don't share the same concern with single family housing, even though those bring in more school children. And interestingly, and there was also another, even if housing did come with children, there was another researcher, Dr. Richard England, who's a professor emeritus at the University of New Hampshire. He was an economics professor, was commissioned by the New Hampshire Association of Realtors, and he did a great report on exactly that topic. Will kids increase my property taxes if there's more kids? And he found no. Having more kids in your community won't increase your property taxes. And it was primarily a misunderstanding of marginal versus average cost. You know, a community has an average cost per kid, but it's not the marginal cost per kid. Bringing in a new kid, the marginal cost of that is actually somewhere around zero. And it's because when you bring in a kid into the community, even if, say, you brought in a dozen kids into a community, you're probably not going to do anything like, you know, build a new classroom or have to build a new school building or hire a new teacher, that kind of thing. So most of school costs are fixed costs, and bringing in a new kid doesn't change that. And that's the other sort of part of this, the kind of flip side, is that density is actually better for our community resources. When you think of, say, you know, you build a house on a road, and if you're, you know, doing some sprawl development, you're building a road, there's one house at the end of the road, that house's property taxes are paying for basically the maintenance of that entire road and whatever else you had to do to get out there. So, like, for example, you know, infrastructure, if you had to run a line out there or something like that, versus if you build several houses, they're all sort of sharing the cost of that added infrastructure to the community. So sprawl is actually what causes your property taxes to go up, not density. And yet we sort of, like, place the blame on this, like, dense multifamily housing causing property taxes to go up. And that's just not the reality. So it's certainly, that's a pervasive myth and one that's been difficult to address effectively.
Yeah, I call it a zombie myth because it just keeps happening despite the fact that, you know, you have these statistics. And this is where you need people in those rooms at that moment to dispel it. I think what happens from the conversations that I heard in these meetings all around the state, and Sarah, tell me if you agree or not, there's a conflating of this idea that everybody seems to know the cost per child in a school system, and that can be anywhere from 15, you know, 1,000, whatever. And it gets conflated to mean that every child added to a community is $15,000, whatever $1,000 that the community has to absorb. And that's just not the case. You know, that those two statistics don't translate, but it's still a very pervasive myth. And I would also say there's a tremendous cost, school cost, to not having kids in your school system. If you want to see your property taxes go up, you know, try that. And the flip side of that is this sense that it's going to lower their property value by having another piece of, you know, another type of housing in the community. And for that, I really believe that we all need to go out and find the projects, because they're out there, that are working, that are set away in a way that you don't see them, you know, from your house, or they're in the middle of the community hiding in plain sight, or they're beautiful projects. We need to show people that these are beneficial projects. They can work in a community, and they're not going to destroy your property values.
Yeah, I would add to your point, Jay, about property values, that there's tons of data that suggests that well-designed workforce or affordable housing actually increases your property values, and as does the like vibrancy and the health of the small businesses in your community. I think can think of communities where throughout the pandemic, the sort of the like great vibrant downtowns with their businesses have started to close. And what effect do you think that has on property values?
And I think we need to show these good projects. I mean, in Exeter, there's a number, not a large number, but some projects that are hiding in plain sight. You wouldn't even know, you know? And I think we need to get those visuals and get those messages out there of what's working.
So thank you both, that's helpful. So we're getting lots of comments and questions in the chat, and I want to make sure that I'm responsive to those. What I also wanted to note is I've heard a couple things, themes about the education that's necessary of maybe planning board members, but maybe members in the community too. Some of the consequences of not going in the opposite direction of density, I guess is how I'll phrase it. What I'd like to revisit is kind of some of the suggestions, other suggestions that exist out there. So for example, in the state of Vermont, my understanding is that the state is incentivizing conversion of some existing stock into multi-family units and giving a considerable incentive to do that. And so I was wondering if you could speak to the experience in the state of New Hampshire in that space.
I don't think there's anything that I love to see more than like large single family, beautiful sort of traditional New Hampshire homes being converted into like multifamily homes. It's from the street. And like to Jay's point, they were hiding in plain sight from the street. It just looks like a beautiful big New Hampshire house. And we have plenty of those sort of big houses that are gorgeous New England style, but too big. And particularly now with the number of single family households going up, but there's tons of other sort of creative solutions that we can apply. I think the most important thing is that the solution should be led by the community and tailored to that specific community's, you know, what they want and what they love about their community and really enhance those things. There's no sort of like one size fits all solution. And we totally recognize when we work with individual communities that we're not going to take, say, Manchester solutions and apply them to Pelham, et cetera. But there's all these opportunities for like incremental development and missing middle development, you know, allowing detached accessory dwelling units or focusing on cottage clusters and pocket neighborhoods, that kind of thing. Got smaller houses on smaller lots. They're more affordable, but they also sort of enhance the community and create this sort of like fantastic, like, you know, housing where the people who live there have this like dignity of having their own place and their own walls and their private space and their public space. And it, you know, you're not just creating housing, you're creating communities and vibrant communities at that. But then there's precedent across the country for other sort of opportunities. Someone in the chat in Ovi was talking about Oregon. Oregon is an example of a community that, or a state rather, that has re-legalized some missing middle housing types. So missing middle housing is anything that's in between a single family house and a multifamily house. So we're talking about duplexes and condos and fourplexes and triplexes and like, you know, garden style apartments and cottage clusters, that kind of thing. And, you know, communities, Oregon, I mentioned, parts of California, and Minneapolis, Minnesota, and St. Petersburg, Florida, sort of randomly, have all sort of like re-legalized this missing middle housing. And they allow for fourplexes in areas that are zoned for single family homes. And so you end up with these really sort of beautiful, whether it's a conversion or a new build, you end up with these sort of beautiful like homes that from the outside look like single family homes. They don't look any different, but they look like, but they actually house more than one person. So it's a really fantastic example. And there was actually a bill in the legislature that would have required communities allow fourplexes in single family zones, and that did not survive the House, but was an opportunity to start this conversation of like, there are certainly communities where that kind of thing would be appropriate.
And there's another, the story wasn't covered in the film or wasn't covered here, but we cover a story in Keene where their issue isn't so much stock as it is the condition of the stock. And with Keene State's enrollment beginning to go down, there's this rental housing that's becoming available. As Mayor George Hansel says, it has great bones, but it hasn't been kept up. It hasn't been updated, and it has fallen into somewhat disrepair. So they're working on a program, and there's more details available on incentivizing and assisting landlords, kind of working out a bargain with them, where they're going in block by block and looking to restore some of this housing and make it available to what Sarah says is that missing middle, taking the stock that they have. And from what I heard from George following up, you know, they're already beginning that process. They've already attacked their first block of housing to get it up to something that the missing middle can live in and live in affordably. And working with the landlords, partnering with the owners of the property to make that happen.
Thank you. So a recent survey from the Center for Ethics and Business and Government at St. Anselm College suggests that the majority of people support the development of workforce housing. I want to go back to my question about what needs to be done to remove these obstacles. And so why isn't that happening on the local level? Is it representatives on planning and zoning boards? Is it a legislature that isn't enabling the flexibility that those planning and zoning boards need? Is it different voices that are necessary in this conversation? It's a long question, but I'd appreciate your insight onto those obstacles.
It's funny that Jay and I were just talking about this sort of idea of people who are, of course, they're in support of workforce housing. We really need workforce housing, except
we have a new myth.
Not like that, not there. That kind of thing. And so there's a lot of folks who, you know, of course they're supportive of workforce housing and what does that really mean? But when it comes to actually implementing solutions, there's a lot of things that get in the way. A big part, of course, is those pervasive myths and misunderstandings. And I think a big part of it is just fear. My observation from serving on a planning board is that we're always sort of planning, instead of like planning for the future and thinking about like, what could our community look like? We're so bogged down with sort of development proposals. So like in Vermont, for example, it's two different boards who do those things. There's one that does development review and one that does actual planning. And we don't get to do a lot of actual planning in the localities in New Hampshire because we're busy reviewing developments. But one of the things that I noticed, my observation was that we were always sort of planning for the worst case scenario. You know, we might look at an ordinance or an amendment that was being proposed and say like, oh, like this one really specific terrible thing could happen if we let this ordinance, you know, pass, or we let this amendment pass. And ultimately we're not thinking about sort of the holistic big picture. Like, yes, this one bad thing could hypothetically happen, I guess, but it's probably not going to, it's not very likely. So planning for the most likely scenario instead of sort of the worst case scenario. But it's a lot of that sort of NIMBYism at the local level, or the taking no for an answer. Sort of one of my pieces of advice that I offer to advocates is that like a community or a local leader might tell you like, no, we can't do workforce housing because X, Y, and Z. Like a common one is we don't have any water and sewer, so we can't do workforce housing. And of course we know that that's not true. Not to say that not having water and sewer doesn't make it more complicated. It certainly does, but it's not impossible to do it. And so encouraging sort of the advocates that I talk to like push on that a little bit and see like, well, is it possible? Here's an example of a project in Exeter that's workforce housing that was built without water and sewer. What do you say to that? So,
yeah. And I think it's that rhetorical sense that everyone's for workforce housing, but when you get into the nitty gritty, I think that in the first film, in the first project, the idea was a lot of educational and trying to get people to understand and change minds. I think in the second one, it's more like if there are some intractable people on boards in those communities, you just have to replace them. You have to have somebody who runs against them, who has an idea of what they want for the community that's more progressive towards housing, and have them run. And I think the second thing that is logical is that of all of the, you know, in my work, I dip into a lot of different industries and a lot of different types of work. And the jargon associated with planning is pretty robust. And I think for a lot of communities, a lot of planning board people and a lot of citizens, the jargon for zoning and planning is not made user-friendly in a way that well-meaning people, I'm not talking about the people who just, the NIMBYs who don't want anything to happen no matter what, but for well-meaning people, it can be very hard to understand the difference between the language and what that means. I mean, look what happened with Ray Shakir. He just didn't get what it meant. And once he did, no, you can't build 100 units on a quarter acre. Oh, okay. So making that more understandable, maybe, you know, the training of planning board people to understand the verbiage, because I know that when I go in, the first thing on a ballot in the local elections are the zoning issues. And if there isn't some sort of user-friendly English about what this means, you know, you're going to vote no, because I don't know. I don't understand what's happening.
I was just going to add, our friend Harrison Kanzler, who's the executive director of the Mount Washington Valley Housing Coalition, always says, just so you know, the only thing that you need in order to run for your planning board or join your planning board, depending on how your community is set up, is to be 18 and live in that community. So I think that jargon and that sort of like scary thing intimidates a lot of people who are not getting involved, when really those are the only two, you know, qualifications that you actually need. Be 18, live in that community. You can join your town's planning board.
One other thing I would add real quick is when I talked to Andrew Winter, he wanted to hammer home too. The role of having employers show up will help move the needle. You know, that isn't just having them write a letter to the paper. You know, it's a combination of things. And what you've seen with what the Corporate Coalition and Clay Adams and that whole group has done in Dartmouth, you know, Health, really showing up as employers and saying, we need this. You know, we need this. That is a huge hammer.
And I would say, Vital Communities in the Upper Valley has been not only a convener, but a driver of that issue. So I would want to point that out. It's interesting, both of you alluded to something that I found really noteworthy in the clip, which was the closing observation, raising the issue alone to elected officials isn't always adequate, right? Yeah. My takeaway was you need a champion there. And so I have another question for Sarah, and then I want to be cognizant of the time, but I would be curious as to what one message each of you has for New Hampshire's local, regional, I think is important to talk about regional, or other people planning on getting involved in this space.
Go ahead, Sarah.
It's hard to pick one piece of advice. I guess I'll go with, you don't have to be an expert to be an advocate. There's a city councilor in Rochester who always says that you don't have to have a PhD because you already have a PhD in your heart, or something like that. I probably butchered her quote, but truly, like, your housing story is the single most important advocacy tool that you have. And whether it be your own personal story or your, you know, I mentioned in the OV comments about, I think about my mom and other older people who are looking to downsize, but can't find something both affordable and, you know, smaller for them to downsize into, and how sort of challenging that is. And I'm sure for other people, you're thinking of sort of maybe your grown children who are coming back from college and want to live in their hometown. Like, those stories, and, you know, that includes employers too, in telling their story of how the housing crisis has affected their business, sort of like the single thing that I would leave with potential advocates. Just know that, like, it is possible in every community to do something, to take some incremental step towards, repairing your solving or being part of the solution toward the region's housing crisis, just tell those stories so that people can relate to it. And it's human and it's not this like scary workforce housing. Here's a definition. It's here's a real thing that's happening in your community to your neighbors and to your employees, et cetera. So that's the one thing I think I'd leave with our advocates.
And I would take it even one step further that if you have, you know, I understand everybody's busy. It's hard to run for planning board. It's hard to serve on a board. I did it for years in Exeter. But if you can't do that, and we need people to do that, but if you can't do that, most communities, almost every community has a Steve Porter, a Jeff Gowan, you know, in Pelham, a Sarah Wrightsman, you know, a Victoria Larissey from Mount Washington Valley, who have taken that baton and they're running with it. And they're trying to, you know, break through. You don't have to repeat what they do. But if you have a person that reminds you of somebody locally that you've seen in the film, just pick up the phone, right, Sarah, and say, okay, I can't give you a lot of time, but what can I do to help that would be most impactful, that would help the most? Is it showing up to a meeting? Is it writing some sort of a letter? Is it adding my name to something? What can I do to help move the rock forward and get some housing built and put some real action to the term advocacy? You don't have to do everything. There are good people who have gone sort of unnoticed. You know, what do they say about planners? Well, the wonderful thing about planners, you know, they're the people who know so much in our community that nobody listens to, you know? So contact these folks, and they don't, most of them don't work full time. That's why I thought it was important to show Steve Porter. He's the meat manager at a supermarket. He doesn't do this 40 hours a week in terms of being on the select board. So find who those people are and find out how you can buttress what they're doing.
Thank you. I mean, it reminds me, frankly, to the fact that we have a citizen legislature in New Hampshire, right? I mean, these are your neighbors. And I trust the same is true even more intimately of your planning and zoning board members. So, okay, Sarah, I have one more question for you before wrap up, which is, in your best estimate, how many units for the missing middle are needed in New Hampshire right now? 5,000, 10,000, 50,000?
The sort of like magic number that I always hear, and I don't know exactly where this came from, but I always hear that we need, you know, the state of New Hampshire needs 20,000 housing units. That's how short we are of housing units. And I'm not sure exactly where that came from or how accurate it is or how outdated it is, because it might be different now. But say like Nashua, for example, just did a housing study in their community last year, and they found that Nashua itself was short, so 4,000 units, and that's, you know, it's a lot of units. And I think that every sort of little bit helps and every unit helps. And that's why we focus so much on these like incremental sort of solutions, which are a lot less scary. Like thinking about adding 20,000 units is scary, but thinking about like allowing detached ADUs and allowing homeowners to have that option to add some incremental and some small units to the community makes a big difference in the long run if all of the communities work together to do it, which is a really important point, that every community has to be part of this solution. Because housing, of course, is a regional topic. Housing and jobs are regional, they're not local, but the solutions, the zoning, that is local. And so that disconnect there sort of has to be bridged in some way or another.
Well, that will be the last word for this hour. So many thanks to our panelists, Jay Childs, the producer of Communities and Consequences 2. You can watch the film, download a discussion guide, and purchase the companion book on nhpbs.org. Thanks also to Sarah Wrightsman, Executive Director of the Workforce Housing Coalition of the Greater Seacoast and the Housing Coordinator for the Regional Economic Development Center. Thank you for sharing your time and expertise with us this afternoon.
Thank you, Matthew.
And thank you all in the audience for joining us. This project is about communities working together and the future of New Hampshire. We encourage everyone to read the book, watch the film, and then go out, get involved, and make a difference. Thank you, and have a great afternoon.